Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining in today at 4 p.m. Today is an interesting session, and I've got two distinguished speakers with me. Well, it's been post-COVID about a year and a half, and we are lucky enough to be connected through digital media, and it's been something that the financial services industry has been at the forefront of adapting it. We have seen a lot of transactions in mutual funds going through digital platforms. We have been staying in touch with our partners as well as our clients through digital media. And this is not just the financial services industry. In the last 1.5 years, we've also seen vaccinations taking place. India has been at the forefront of not only manufacturing it, but a lot of people also getting vaccinated. And one thing which we have seen is the digitization of even the certification of vaccine that is happening. While we are talking about vaccines, COVID, also talking about financial services, there is one big, a major revolution which is also happening on the manufacturing side. There is automation and digitization that is happening. Are we at the cusp of the new revolution in the manufacturing or engineering side? To know more about it, I've got two distinguished speakers, Mr. Rohit Singhania. Rohit has been with the firm since September 2005, almost 2 decades plus with the firm, managing some of the most esteemed portfolios, which is DSP Equity Opportunities Portfolio, our DSP Tax Saver Portfolio, and also being a co-fund manager for DSP Natural Resources and New Energy Fund. With that, I would like to hand over to Rohit, who can take over the next session.
Thank you, Nikhil. Good evening, all, and thank you for giving us, you know, this opportunity to talk to you about something which we really believe, you know, can do good for us over the next few years. So before I head into the, you know, let me just introduce Charanjit Singh. I think most of you all would be seeing him and hearing him today for the first time. So Charanjit joined us exactly 3 years back as a capital goods and infra analyst. Prior to joining us, he has been working in the sell side broking community, and he's been tracking this sector for more than 14 years. So in all, Charanjit has got an experience of more than 18 years in looking at engineering, industrial infrastructure, you know, digital companies in his career. So I think the knowledge which he shares is of great importance to us. This year in January, we inducted him as a co-fund manager for Tiger Fund. And he's been very instrumental in, you know, driving the fund and how should we position the fund to the investors. So that is Charanjit for you all. You all will be hearing more from him later. So coming to the point. So, you know, why did Nikhil Kamath say engineering, manufacturing, digitization? He would have said infrastructure fund. Tiger is an infrastructure fund, right? That's how we all know. The Tiger means infrastructure. And now when we say infrastructure, what comes to the first thing in our mind is 2002 se leke 2010 mein kya hua tha, right? We talk about big power plants set up hoye the, bade cement plants set up hoye the, steel plants set up hoye the, ports set up hoye the, railway line set up hui thi, right? So when we think of infrastructure, we think big plans. There will be a 20,000 crore capex announcement, there will be a 10,000 crore capex announcement. Wo hamare, you know, it's in our minds because that was, we have been used to till now, right? Infrastructure means big capex drivers. Capex hoega, that means infrastructure hoega, manufacturing hoegi. But today, as we stand, you know, 14 years down the line, yes, the big name is still called infrastructure. But the infrastructure ka jo umbrella hai, what is below the umbrella has changed. Now, I'll give you with a simple example, right? 15 saal pehle hum log power capacity ki baat karte the. Ki India mein power demand jyada hai, capacity is less. So we need more power plants, right? So you had companies who were making equipments to make those power plants. Say example, aap koi boiler banata tha, koi turbine banati thi, right? So those companies weren't fancy at that point of time because we wanted to add power capacity. Today, as we stand, at least for the next 2 years, the view is in India, the power capacity is more than the demand. So why will new power plants be set up? One. Secondly, whatever power plants have been setting up today, I mean, hardly anyone is setting up coal-fired power plant, right? Which was more than 90% in that period, 2002 to 2010. Today, we all talk about renewable. Yeah, I want to set up a solar power plant, wind energy or hydro. So how the thought has changed, right? So today, as investors, as analysts, when you're looking at the power sector, instead of focusing on power generators who generate turbine and boilers, we look at people who have power capacity. If today the PLF goes up, unki profits bharenge, ROE bharenge, cash flow bharenge. So the whole definition of power is still the same, but from manufacturers to people who own power capacity. So that's how, you know, it's a small thing change. वन थिंग डिफरेंस इज जो आप 10 साल पहले कैपेक्स करते थे, वी यूज्ड टू से इफ आई एम स्पेंडिंग 5000 करोड़ इन अ कैपेक्स, द रेवेन्यू पोटेंशियल ऑफ दिस 5000 करोड़ वाज मैक्सिमम 5000 टू 8000 करोड़, 1 टू 1.2 1.3 टाइम्स आपने कितना कैपेक्स किया है. टुडे व्हेन अ कंपनी टेल्स मी कि आई एम सेटिंग अप 1000 करोड़ प्रोजेक्ट और 1000 करोड़ कैपेक्स, दैट कंपनी टुडे इज सेइंग एटलीस्ट इफ नॉट मोर आई विल डू अ 2000 करोड़ टू 2000 करोड़ रेवेन्यू फ्रॉम दैट कैपेक्स. इसका क्या मतलब है, जो 10 साल पहले इनपुट आउटपुट आउटपुट रेशियो था एंड टुडेज इनपुट आउटपुट रेशियो इज सिग्निफिकेंटली हायर देन व्हाट इट वाज 10 इयर्स बैक, राइट. सो व्हाई इट हैज हैपेंड, टुडे अ कंपनी इज स्पेंडिंग लेस कैपेक्स बट गेटिंग मोर रेवेन्यू बिकॉज देयर प्लान्स आर बिकमिंग मोर ऑटोमेटेड. दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट डिजिटाइजेशन, लॉट ऑफ कंपनीज आर सेइंग कि वी हैव दिस काइंड ऑफ पेटेंट, इफ यू यूज दिस टेक्नोलॉजी वी विल बी मोर एनर्जी एफिशियंट, you know, we will be more efficient in terms of costing. So again, there are different companies. 20 years back, we just used to focus on capacity dalni hai. Now we are focusing on, yes, we have to maybe put capacity, but what current capacity we have? How can we make it more efficient? Hamara ji costing hai, hum kaise kam kar sakte hain? Hamare product ko hum kaise improve kar sakte hain in terms of quality for our customers? So that is a talk today. Let's talk about water. So today we know this government in the last so many years have been focusing on bhai sabko peene ka pani kaise mile, right. Now what is the chain? Now water in India, there is enough water, but there is not enough drinking water or you know usable water as such. So agar uska jo focus hai, uski value chain mein kaun si companies hain, you know, who set up desalination plants, agar aaj aapko 200 km pani transport karna hai, so how do you transport, you know, who are the companies who are making those pipes for transporting the water, who are the companies who are setting up desalination plants. So the whole definition jo infra ka hai na, hame wo nikalna padega ki badi badi buildinge banengi. Ha banengi, real estate abhi bhi banega, but badi badi buildinge, 200 million ton ke steel plant, cement plant aayenge, wo aayenge lekin abhi nahi aayenge, dheere dheere aayenge. Abhi kya hai, jinke paas asset hai, jinke paas capacity hai, wo usko kaise utilize karegi, that is the key with me to look at it. Now take for example steel and cement. 2002-2005 if I remember right, अपनी स्टील की कैपेसिटी इंडिया में 30 मिलियन टन से कम थी एंड द सीमेंट कैपेसिटी वॉज अराउंड 220-230 मिलियन टन. आज के दिन हम बात कर रहे हैं स्टील कैपेसिटी है 110-120 मिलियन टन के आसपास एंड सीमेंट क्लोज टू 500 मिलियन टन. आज जब मैं ये कैपेसिटी यूटिलाइजेशन देखता हूँ इन कंपनीज का, तो मुझे लगता है अभी बड़ा कैपेसिटी 100 की 200 तो जल्दी से नहीं होगी, नाइदर सीमेंट की 500 से 700 जल्दी होगी, हाँ 500 से 600 जरूर होगी. सो इन दिस पीरियड व्हाट इज माय फोकस, 2002 टू 2005 माय फोकस वाज कंपनीज जो सीमेंट प्लांट बनाती हैं, कंपनीज जो स्टील प्लांट बनाती हैं. टुडे द फोकस इज स्टील मैन्युफैक्चरर्स एंड सीमेंट मैन्युफैक्चरर्स, कि उनके पास ऑलरेडी कैपेसिटी है, दे आर एफिशिएंट मैन्युफैक्चरर्स. अगर हमारी इकोनॉमी पिकअप होगी, ग्रोथ आएगी, तो ऑटोमेटिकली उनको बेनिफिट मिलेगा. सो वी हैव टू स्लाइटली शिफ्ट अ बेस कि भाई मैन्युफैक्चरिंग कैपेसिटी है वो भी तो उसका कैसा चल रहा है, आज के दिन क्या पीएलएफ है. इट डजंट मीन कि इफ आई सेट अप न्यू कैपेसिटी देन ओनली माय कंपनी विल मेक मनी, देन ओनली माय कंपनीज कैपेसिटी यूटिलाइजेशन विल पिक अप. नो, दैट इज नॉट द केस. लास्ट मैं आपको एक चीज बोलना चाहूंगा, डेटा सेंटर्स. आपने सब में अपने हर न्यूज़पेपर में सुना होगा, पिछले 6 महीने से बात हो रही है कि हर कंपनी बोल रही है हम डेटा सेंटर बनाएंगे. अभी डेटा सेंटर, व्हाट इज डेटा सेंटर? आज के दिन आप और मैं जो भी प्रोसेसिंग करते हैं, हमारा डेटा जो होता है, जो भी कंपनी प्रोसेसिंग करती हैं, आज के दिन इंडिया के बाहर वो प्रोसेस होता है. वो गवर्नमेंट ने बोला है कि अभी वो प्रोसेसिंग इंडिया में ही होनी चाहिए. तो आज के दिन हमारे पास कोई ऐसी कंपनी नहीं है, ना इंडिया में कोई लिस्टेड है जो डेटा सेंटर ओन करती है. बट अगर इंडिया में डेटा सेंटर अगर बनना है तो उसमें अंदर क्या जाता है, पावर केबल, उनको एयर कंडीशनिंग बड़ी चाहिए होती है, इन सब चीजें की जो कंपनी जो मैन्युफैक्चर करती है दे विल बेनिफिट. नाउ कमिंग टू प्योर कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड यू नो व्हेन यू से कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड बिल्डिंग, लास्ट 5-6 इयर्स हैज बीन ओनली रोड्स, मेट्रोज एंड रेलवेज, और कहीं ज्यादा कुछ कैपेक्स नहीं हुआ है. गोइंग फॉरवर्ड ऑल्सो वी फील कि नेक्स्ट 2-3 इयर्स एटलीस्ट इफ नॉट मोर, जो प्योर इंफ्रा जो हम लोग बोलते हैं ना, वो रोड इंफ्रा या अर्बन इंफ्रा रहने वाला है. इट्स नॉट गोइंग टू बी अक्रॉस द बोर्ड. आज हमें नए पोर्ट चाहिए, नहीं चाहिए, यू नो, नए ग्रीन फील्ड प्लांट्स चाहिए, नहीं चाहिए. तो रोड एक सेक्टर लगता है या अर्बन इंफ्रा जहाँ पर थिंग्स इंप्रूव होंगी, सो फोकस ऑन दैट. सो व्हाट आई वांटेड टू स्टार्ट विथ इज, यस, हमने 15 साल से इंफ्रा सुनते आए हैं, इंफ्रा एंड टाइगर वी हैव रिलेटेड टू इंफ्रा. यस, इट इज अ इंफ्रा अम्ब्रेला, बट आज के दिन जो कंपनीज हम देख रहे हैं उनमें बेनिफिट्स जो अगले 2-3 साल में हम आने लग रहे हैं हमें देख रहे हैं. सो दैट इज वन थिंग आई वॉन्ट एवरी वन टू थिंक डिफरेंटली, यू नो, दैट्स सेकेंडली. नाउ लास्टली, हमें ये थीम क्यों अच्छी लगती है, राइट? तो चरण विल टॉक अबाउट लॉट इन दैट, बट आई जस्ट गिव यू टू पॉइंट्स. आज जब हम इंफ्रा की बात करते हैं, मैन्युफैक्चरिंग की बात करते हैं, इंजीनियरिंग की बात करते हैं, इसमें गवर्नमेंट का बड़ा इंपॉर्टेंट रोल होता है. हमारे इंडिया की कंट्री के मैक्रोस कैसे हैं वो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट होते हैं. चरणदीप विल टॉक टू यू अबाउट GST, PLI, जो पिछले लास्ट 2-3-4 साल में गवर्नमेंट ने किया है, तो उसे हमें लगता है कि एटलीस्ट यू नो गवर्नमेंट हैज द विलिंगनेस टू डू द राइट थिंग्स, टेक द बोल्ड स्टेप. इन सब चीज़ों की, फॉर एग्जाम्पल, लेबर रिफॉर्म हम कितने सालों से बात करते आ रहे हैं, फाइनली पिछले 3-4 साल में ये हुए हैं, आगे बढ़े हैं. तो एटलीस्ट फ्रॉम द गवर्नमेंट साइड हमें लगता है कि जो हमने 2014-2015-17 में देखे थे, अपने इन्वायरमेंटल इश्यूज सुने होंगे, वो सब सुने होंगे, आई थिंक वो सब अभी इट्स अ थिंग ऑफ द पास्ट. द गवर्नमेंट हैज ऑल्सो रियलाइज. सेकेंडली, नेक्स्ट ईयर देर इज अ बिग स्टेट इलेक्शन, ईयर आफ्टर दैट देर इज अ सेंट्रल इलेक्शन. So the view is, at least, you know, this government is very smart. They're doing the right things, and we should not see any variances in their policies. Lastly, जो हमारा macro है, आज हम जो bank की liquidity देखें, हमारा current account deficit देखें, हमारा forex reserves देखें, I think that gives us confidence कि on the macro level, अगर आज capex cycle जो हम बोल रहे हैं, आज government खाली capex कर रही है, private sector 6-9 महीने बात करेगी, पर उसमें it gives me that confidence to say yes. The way we have built up and identified companies in the fund, top down what views we are seeing, it gives us confidence and to come and repitch the Tiger Fund to you all. So I think this is what I had to say in my initial remarks. I'll hand it over to Charan to talk more about various points which I have spoken to in some detail and also take us through the Tiger Fund. Thank you. Over to you, Charan.
Yeah. Thanks, Rohit, for the setting the context for the Tiger Fund. Which is focused on manufacturing engineering side. So I think before I start, like, you know, Rohit talked about what are we including in the fund and what we are excluding. So if you look at this slide, this clearly shows that we are focusing on the core of the theme, right to the level, looking at construction, engineering, manufacturing, core sectors, economic reform themes like chemicals, fertilizers, consumer goods, financial platforms. And we are excluding the lenders, we are excluding pharma, IT, and consumer staples from this fund. That's what we are excluding from the structure in the holding. Now, at any point of time, the most important question is where we are in the cycle. And if, as investors, we are able to get that right, we can have a good visibility for 3 to 5 years, stay invested in the theme. So, most important to understand, in the last 15 years, investment to GDP ratio, that's a good indicator to help us understand where we are in the cycle. Uske liye agar aap dekhenge the data point on the screen, FY21, what we have seen is ki cycle bottom ho gaya. In terms of investment to GDP is at around 27%, and similar number we had seen in FY2000, where again bottoming happened, and post that FY03 to 07, we had a super capex cycle where investment to GDP then touched 36%. So this is giving us a good indicator that the cycle has bottomed out. And now we'll also talk about the indicators which are giving us the confidence that why it should improve from here. The other thing is, if a country has to grow, our GDP has to grow, then infrastructure investment is the key. The government cannot shy away from that, and they have to invest for the growth in the GDP and also for growth in the jobs. So that's the first context, that where we are in the cycle. Now what we'll do is, we'll look at the indicators, what we saw when the last capex cycle picked up. How I'll split it up into two parts. One is the macros, other part is the reforms. So when we look at, again, 15 saal ka data hum dekhte hain, aur jab last capex cycle pick up kiya, to tab us waqt kya factors the, variables the, jinhone ye capex cycle ko drive kiya. And what we see, banks play a very important role in terms of financing, and their balance sheets have now become much more stronger, kyunki NPAs unke kam ho gaye. Non-performing assets have come down. NCLT resolutions have happened over the last 3 to 5 years. that has again, you know, brought down the capacities which are stuck because of these resolutions. Cost of financing, if you see the chart here, is at 2 decades low. Again, this is a very big indicator for overall CapEx cycle to pick up. And lastly, what we think as a game changer is the corporate tax rate cut. Corporate tax rate cut for new manufacturing capacity, government has made it 15%. So that's a big game changer, because now we are talking about competing with other geographies in Asia like Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia, and talking about India can become a manufacturing hub for the world. And I'll tell you how government is working towards that to make India as a factory to the world. So macro indicators are in our favor, giving us a lot of confidence that things are, you know, have bottomed out, and from here on things can improve. Next point is in terms of, if you look at the capital expenditure and capacity utilization. But before I go to that, I think I would also like to touch on the reforms part. So reforms, आप देखेंगे कि कभी भी हम पिछले साइकिल में भी जाते हैं तो reforms were very critical part of the capex cycle to revive, क्योंकि उसी से आप इतनी massive changes करते हैं जिससे आपकी investment फिर से pick up होती है. So if you look at last cycle when the capex super capex cycle picked up, at that point of time Electricity Act was the biggest reform which the government did. What it did was it opened up the power sector and led to huge investments in the power generation space, which we had not even thought about, and that is how the cycle picked up, and it was a big cycle. Now what has happened in 3 to 5 years, last 3 to 5 years, government has done a lot of reforms. GST, because GST has led to more formalization of the economy. Ki jo organized players hain, jo branded players hain, large companies who are paying taxes, they will become more larger because they are already part of the organized system. Corporate tax rate cut, I've already talked about, 15% is real game changer. What we are seeing is also, you know, distribution reforms. So power distribution reforms, I think, again, are very important. Like we saw reforms in terms of getting players into power generation in the private side in the last cycle, this side we'll see distribution reforms. What will happen is that the distribution, which is B2C part of the business, that will get privatized more and more. We'll see more capex happening on that end. And another important thing which will be there is our power tariffs, which are very high for industries right now globally. They will see more rationalization because we'll bring in more efficiency in the system. So you again see the thought process to make our manufacturing again more competitive versus the world, to make us as a global factory for the world. RERA, which is again another important regulation for the real estate, which brought in a lot of consolidation, and now we are seeing the benefits as the real estate cycle is coming back. I think the other game changer is production linked incentives. Now what is happening with the production linked incentive? Government saw that there's a very clear lifetime opportunity which India is getting to scale up manufacturing. There was China-US trade wars, which led to companies globally think about having a China plus one strategy. Then COVID came, which actually accelerated this. This could have taken actually 5 or 10 years, but COVID accelerated this because everywhere the supply chains got disrupted. Jaise hi wo aapka hua, to companies started thinking कि इफ दे हैव टू सस्टेनेबली प्रोड्यूस तो उनको कोई और ट्रेड पार्टनर चाहिए, उनको कोई और मैन्युफैक्चरिंग कंट्री चाहिए जो उनके लिए रिलायबली मैन्युफैक्चर कर सके, एंड इंडिया फिट्स दैट बिल. बट गवर्नमेंट इज ऑल्सो सपोर्टिंग दैट, गवर्नमेंट अंडरस्टैंड दैट, एंड हाउ दे आर सपोर्टिंग. फर्स्ट, इम्पोजिशन ऑफ ड्यूटीज, बहुत सारे प्रोडक्ट्स ऐसे जिसपे गवर्नमेंट ने ड्यूटीज लगा दी. सेकेंड इज इम्पोर्ट बैंस, विच आर इम्पोर्टेड फ्रॉम चाइना, यू कैनॉट इम्पोर्ट देम एनी मोर. Thirdly is production linked incentive. And what I would like to say is PLI is not a subsidy. It is, you set up a capacity in India, aap manufacture kariye, revenue generate kariye, uske upar aapko 4-5% ka incentive milega. So in 5 years time frame, actually an entrepreneur who is going to set up a capacity, uski capacity free ho jayegi, because you are going to get that kind of an incentive. So it's a big game changer for anybody who is looking at incentives. Other question which comes is, while private sector is keen to invest or not, so we saw success in the mobile phones, and it was not only Indian companies, Korean, Taiwanese companies who participated in the PLI for the mobile phones. That gave the confidence to the government to bring in PLI for 13 sectors totally. And what I'll tell you is that another thing, there was a bid for solar PV modules for 10 gigawatt. Aur uske liye jo bids aaye hain, woh hai 55 gigawatt. So see the kind of interest which is there from the private sector to back the segments where we have good visibility, and that is what we have to do. कि अपनी इकोनॉमी में कहां पे अपने को अच्छी ग्रोथ दिख रही है, विच सेगमेंट्स कैन गिव अस 3-2 years विजिबिलिटी, एंड विच आर द गुड थीम्स टू सस्टेन. लास्ट इज लेबर रिफॉर्म्स. लेबर रिफॉर्म्स इन इंडिया हैव बीन वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स. where now government is trying to simplify this code so that multinationals can come and set up capacities here. And I think all these are very big game changers because they simplify, for any multinational to come and set up capacity and scale up their manufacturing. That is what will make us as manufacturers for the world. The other point which I would like to highlight is that there are three engines to the investment. सबसे पहला इंजन है आपका गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग. गवर्नमेंट इज द फर्स्ट इन एनी कैपिटल साइकिल टू गिव द कॉन्फिडेंस. वंस दे स्टार्ट स्पेंडिंग देन द प्राइवेट स्पेंडिंग पिक्स अप. एंड द थर्ड इंजन इज रियल एस्टेट. आई विल टॉक अबाउट ईच ऑफ दीज थ्री इंजन सेपरेटली नाउ एंड क्यों हमें तीनों में ही बहुत पॉजिटिव व्यू लग रहा है एंड वाई वी थिंक दैट थिंग्स कैन पिक अप इन ईच ऑफ दीज सेगमेंट. सबसे पहले लेते हैं गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग. गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग का आप ये चार्ट देखेंगे विच इज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग चार्ट कि 2.5% ऑफ द जीडीपी इज बीइंग स्पेंट इन FY22 वी आर गेटिंग इंपैक्टेड बाय कोविड बट गवर्नमेंट ने अपनी स्पेंडिंग कट नहीं की है. वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन मोर देन 20% ग्रोथ इन इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर स्पेंडिंग बाय द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट एंड व्हेन वी हैड सीन दिस काइंड ऑफ अ लास्ट नंबर वाज इन FY08. द अदर पॉइंट इज यू विल हैव राइटली अ क्वेश्चन कि ये तो एक साल का आप बोल रहे हैं, 3 से 5 साल का विजिबिलिटी कहां है मेरे पास. So, वो विजिबिलिटी कैसे आ रही है? गवर्नमेंट हैज कम अप विद समथिंग कॉल्ड नेशनल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पाइपलाइन. ये नेशनल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पाइपलाइन हमें क्या बोलती है कि गवर्नमेंट कह रही है कि हम 100 लाख करोड़ से ऊपर का खर्चा करेंगे 20 से लेके 25 तक. अभी मैं आपको यही नंबर बताता हूँ, 13 से लेके 19 में अगर हम ये देखेंगे दिस वॉज अ 50 लाख करोड़ का खर्चा. तो आपका डबल हम इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर स्पेंडिंग कर रहे हैं डिस्पाइट गेटिंग इंपैक्टेड बाय कोविड. 100 लाख करोड़ से ऊपर का खर्चा होगा इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पे. और ये जो सेगमेंट्स हैं इसमें आएगा लाइक रोहित जी मेंशन अबाउट अर्बन इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, मेट्रोज, रेलवेज, रोड्स डेफिनेटली वन ऑफ द सेगमेंट विल कंटिन्यू टू बी. एयरपोर्ट्स आल्सो विल सी सम स्पेंडिंग. सो दैट इज वेयर व्हाट इज गिविंग अस द पॉजिटिव व्यूज ऑन द गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग. सेकेंड आस्पेक्ट इज ऑन द प्राइवेट साइड. तो प्राइवेट में आज की डेट में आपको दिखेगा कैपेसिटी यूटिलाइजेशन जो है आरबीआई का डेटा शो कर रहा है 69%. बट द पॉइंट इज अगर आप देख रहे हैं कि इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर स्पेंडिंग डबल होने वाली है मेरी एंड द काइंड ऑफ स्केल इज 100 लाख करोड़ नॉट 50 लाख करोड़ व्हाट वी सी इन द लास्ट साइकिल. इसका मतलब है मेरा डिमांड फॉर सीमेंट, स्टील, कैपिटल इक्विपमेंट सब बढ़ेगा उससे. नाउ व्हाट हैपेंस इज कैपेसिटी यूटिलाइजेशन आल्सो कैचेस अप. अगर आप एक सीमेंट मैन्युफैक्चरिंग कंपनी या स्टील मैन्युफैक्चरिंग कंपनी है, आपने देखा कि मेरा डिमांड ग्रोथ बहुत स्ट्रांग है तो आपको प्लांट डालने में 3 से 4 साल लगेंगे. इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू कम अप इन अ डे. सो वट आर द लीड इंडिकेटर्स जो आपको देखना पड़ेगा? अनाउंसमेंट्स. तो हमने देखा ऑलरेडी अनाउंसमेंट्स आने लगी. सीमेंट हैज अनाउंस्ड 74 मिलियन टन ऑफ कैपेसिटी. स्टील 25 to 30 मिलियन टन ऑफ कैपेसिटीज हैव बीन अनाउंस्ड. सो अनाउंसमेंट्स आर ऑलरेडी देयर दैट विल ट्रांसलेट इनटू ऑर्डर्स और फिर आपका एग्जीक्यूशन होगा और आपका रेवेन्यू जनरेशन फॉर द कैपिटल इक्विपमेंट कंपनीज विल हैपन. दैट इज हाउ द साइकिल पिक्स अप एंड वी हैव गॉट क्लियर इंडिकेटर्स व्हिच आर गिविंग अस कॉन्फिडेंस ऑन गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग एंड प्राइवेट कैपिटलाइजेशन. How it will pick up. Next slide, which I would like to highlight to you, is on the real estate sector. Real estate, जैसे रोहित जी ने बोला, वो हमारा तीसरा इंजन है. Government, private, real estate. Real estate आप देखेंगे तो पिछले काफी साल से वीक चल रहा है. The impact on real estate actually was caused because of पहले आपका आया demonetization, फिर आपका आया RERA, फिर आपका आया GST implementation. All these three things had big impact on the real estate sector because of which it continued to remain very weak. अभी हमें real estate sector में क्या confidence मिल रहा है? सबसे पहली बात है home loan rates, आपको पता है कि they are already at very low levels. Secondly, affordability has improved. Third point, which is the most important, कि जो inventory levels हैं वो अभी बहुत कम हो गए. Inventory levels, अगर अपनी demand जो है वो FY20 levels पे ही चलती रहेगी, what we see is that inventory levels will dip to almost around 18 months of inventory, X of stalled projects. And this is the level of inventory what we saw at the beginning of the last upcycle. So what we'll see is that आप देखेंगे कि और launches शुरू होंगे real estate में and more absorption will happen. So how we have tried to do is, looking at a thematic fund and looking at how to reduce the risk, we are trying to play the entire real estate cycle pickup through basket of building materials. आप देखिए स्क्रीन पे बिल्डिंग मटेरियल्स, केबल्स, वायर्स, पेंट्स, कंज्यूमर इलेक्ट्रिकल्स एंड कंज्यूमर ड्यूरेबल्स. अब इसमें हमारा थॉट प्रोसेस ऐसा है, रियल एस्टेट मोस्ट ऑफ द प्लेयर्स यू विल हैव हु पार्टिसिपेट मोनली इन द टीयर वन मार्केट्स. इंडिया इज अ बिग कंट्री, टीयर टू, टीयर थ्री, रूरल, एवरीवेयर वी आर सीइंग रियल एस्टेट ग्रोइंग बाय एनॉर्मस रेट्स. हाउ डू कैप्चर दैट ग्रोथ अक्रॉस द कंट्री? आपको उसको कैप्चर करना है तो यू कैन एक्चुअली कैप्चर इट थ्रू दीज प्रोडक्ट बास्केट विच कैन एक्चुअली गिव यू मोर सस्टेन्ड ग्रोथ. सो हमारा थॉट प्रोसेस है कि ईच ऑफ दीज सेगमेंट्स दे हैव नॉट ओनली वन लेग ऑफ ग्रोथ ऑफ रियल एस्टेट बट मल्टीपल लेग्स ऑफ ग्रोथ. उसका आंसर ये है, अब आप केबल्स एंड वायर्स देखिए या कंज्यूमर इलेक्ट्रिकल्स देखिए, गवर्नमेंट हैज ऑलरेडी अचीव 99% इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन इन रूरल एंड अर्बन हाउसेस. जब एक बार किसी के घर पे इलेक्ट्रिसिटी पहुंचेगी द डिमांड विल बी देयर फॉर वायर्स फैंस ऑल दीज प्रोडक्ट्स विल बी इन डिमांड प्लस देयर बी आल्सो डिमांड विच विल राइज फॉर कंज्यूमर ड्यूरेबल्स. लाइक वी हैव टॉक अबाउट जीएसटी, व्हाट इट इज डूइंग इज इट इज फॉर्मलाइजिंग द इकोनॉमी. आपके जो अनऑर्गेनाइज प्लेयर्स थे दे आर गिविंग शेयर टू ऑर्गेनाइज, दे आर गेटिंग ऑर्गेनाइज गाइज आर गेटिंग बिगर, सो देयर इज अ मोर ग्रोथ विच कैन कम बिकॉज ऑफ दैट. And thirdly, all these companies are trying to penetrate more deeper within the country. Tier 2, Tier 3 में जाके growth capture कर रहे हैं, which gives us the confidence that there are multiple legs of growth if we are able to participate in the real estate cycle through this basket approach. And that gives us, you know, a more secular growth in a cyclical fund. The next point is private capex. हमने private capex की थोड़ी बात करी है कि engine हमें लग रहा है कि private capex is definitely picking up. I would like to highlight further few points on the private capex. Rohit ji talked about steel, cement. These are core sectors. In me capex hoga, infrastructure capex pick up karega. There's no option. They will add capacities. Already announcements have come through and ordering will also start. But har cycle mein aap dekhenge ki there are new capex drivers. What are these new capex drivers? And these are, see what we are saying is there are a lot of places where capex is not an option. It's a necessity. Now when we are talking about मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, इंडिया बिकमिंग अ ग्लोबल मैन्युफैक्चरिंग हब, फैक्ट्री टू द वर्ल्ड, आप वो तभी बन सकते हैं जब आपके प्लांट्स ऑटोमेटेड हैं, जब आप ग्लोबल लेवल की क्वालिटी प्रोड्यूस करते हैं. उसी के लिए क्या हो रहा है कि देयर इज अ न्यू थीम विच इज एमर्जिंग नॉट ओनली इन इंडिया बट इट्स अ ग्लोबल थीम ऑफ डिजिटलाइजेशन एंड ऑटोमेशन. आप अभी आज की डेट में किसी भी कंपनी से इंटरेक्ट करेंगे, दे वॉन्ट टू ऑटोमेट, दे वॉन्ट टू डिजिटलाइज. और ये जो थॉट प्रोसेस है ये एक्चुअली अगेन गॉट एक्सेलरेटेड बाय कोविड. जो आपका इसको 5 या 10 साल लगना था, इट हैज गॉट एक्सेलरेटेड राइट नाउ एंड द रीजन फॉर दैट इज कोविड. बिकॉज कोविड के टाइम पे जब आपका सप्लाई चेन डिस्ट्रप्शंस आया, कंपनीज वांटेड टू मैनेज देयर प्लांट्स रिमोटली, कंपनीज वांटेड टू एग्जीक्यूट प्रोजेक्ट्स रिमोटली, एंड व्हाट वी आर सीइंग इज दैट अगर आपको ग्लोबली कम्पीट करना है यू हैव टू मेंटेन योर मैन्युफैक्चरिंग लेवल्स. सो आपको जो डिजिटलाइजेशन है, ऑटोमेशन है, क्या प्रोवाइड करता है? आज की डेट में मैंने प्रोडक्ट बनाया, मेरे को फास्ट मार्केट अप्रोच करना है, मुझे एनर्जी सेव करनी है, और थर्डली मुझे मास कस्टमाइजेशन करने की कैपेबिलिटी है. ये सब चीजें जो है डिजिटलाइजेशन और ऑटोमेशन ही प्रोवाइड करता है. सेकेंड इज डेटा सेंटर्स. अब डेटा सेंटर्स क्यों और कैसे हम कैप्चर कर सकते हैं? एज अ इंडिविजुअल, एज ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, बैंक्स, गवर्नमेंट, वी आर जनरेटिंग ह्यूमंगस अमाउंट ऑफ डेटा जो हमने कभी सोचा भी नहीं था. सो दिस डेटा जनरेशन, government is saying you cannot locate these servers abroad, you have to locate them in the country itself. So it means that data generation capacity has to be added in India. Agar data centers ki capacity hum dekhenge, it is going to be 5x in next by FY26 aur 75,000 to 80,000 crores ka expenditure hoga is. So what we are seeing is that data centers is a new capex driver along with digitalization and automation, which is another new thing. Performance linked incentive, इसके ऊपर जो खर्चा होगा 1.4 लाख करोड़ ऑफ कैपेक्स इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू बी स्पेंड, एंड देयर विल बी अ लॉट ऑफ इंपोर्ट सब्स्टिट्यूशन बिकॉज लॉट ऑफ दीज प्रोडक्ट्स विच आर गेटिंग इंपोर्टेड. तो ये अभी आपके इंडिया में मैन्युफैक्चर होने लग जाएंगे, ऑटोमोबाइल्स पार्ट्स, रूम एसीज, सोलर पीवी मॉड्यूल्स, केमिकल्स, फार्मा, ऑल दीज विल स्टार्ट गेटिंग मैन्युफैक्चर्ड इन इंडिया, दैट विल रिक्वायर दिस 1.4 लाख ऑफ करोड़ ऑफ कैपेक्स. रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी, there's a big shift from coal based power generation in the last cycle to renewable. Renewable kya hai aapka? Solar, wind. Government itself is pushing that we have to achieve around 450 gigawatt of renewables capacity by 2030, jo aaj ki date mein sirf 92 gigawatt hai. So there's a big runway again for growth for this capex, and this is being pushed because of the climate change. Lastly, EV ecosystem, electric vehicles. Electric vehicles, it is not only about the electric vehicles, but it is also about the infrastructure which is there behind. Because aapko grid chahiye itni strong, charging infrastructure chahiye aapko. Uske liye sab aap pehle preparation karenge, then only your EVs will start evolving in the Indian context. So what we are seeing is that these are all new capex drivers in the private space. Again, not an option, but a necessity, which you have to spend. And that is how private sector will scale up in the spending. Yeah, this is what Rohitji also talked about. So I think this is a, you know, very summary of the overall things, comparing three decades. Aap 2010s dekhiye, aap 2000 dekhiye, aur 2020s dekhiye. What we are saying is that global liquidity right now is ample, which is very similar to what we saw in 2000s, and now we are seeing in 2020s. RBI policies are favorable. Government focus is extremely high on the infrastructure spending, and banks' balance sheets are strong. So this is summarizing three decades in one slide and giving us again the confidence ki what were the factors at that point of time when we saw super capex cycle, or ab kya hai apna factors, and are they aligning in the same way what we saw in the last time. I think definitely we are aware about the risks, and what we have done is looked at the last 15 years of data to understand what risks exist in terms of whether government spending will happen or not. Secondly, adoption of the new themes. Third is PLI scheme aapki announce hogi, but proper implementation. So as industry specialists, we have to continuously track these risks and be aware how these schemes are panning. Changes in technology, this is one very important thing, because what we are seeing is that change in technology has become much more faster. Jo pehle changes apni 15 saal mein, 10 saal mein hoti thi, abhi 5 saal mein hoti. If your companies are not very innovative to tackle those changes in technologies, they'll not be able to survive. Regulatory changes, and lastly, ESG, environmental, social, and governance. ESG derating can impact particular sectors, and that is what we have to be aware of as risks. This is a very interesting data point, because the investable sectors for Tiger Fund, if you look at their weightage in Nifty 50 index, is only 25% as of September 21. When we go to the peak, December 07, tab iska weightage tha 67%. So you can see how the weight of these sectors have come down in the Nifty 50 index. And that too, in this 25%, 11% of the weight is Reliance. So how do you play this theme? There are indicators which are indicating that positive movement is there, but the weightage on the index is very less. So the only way to do is through the thematic funds, which are focused on these investable sectors. So this is a very important data point in terms of how weights of these sectors have come down drastically. This is from the perspective in terms of our team. And I think we have a very strong team from the research perspective. Every sector which is, you know, going into the fund, that is covered by individual analysts, and that gives us regular inputs in terms of how trends are changing in each of these sectors. Yeah. So lastly, on the framework, I think this is where we have tried to work the maximum, because look at the mistakes of the past, look at what all happened in the sectors, and try to make sure that you have a framework which can help us give more consistent returns. So what we are saying is that, one, we have to pick sectors where we have a good visibility. आप अगर देखेंगे, मैंने गवर्नमेंट स्पेंडिंग की बात करी है, we have talked about 3 to 5 years visibility. Private में हमने कैपेक्स की बात करी है, अगेन there's a visibility of that spending, and that too for longer term, so that you can stay invested. Real estate cycle जो अभी पिक कर रहे हैं, it should also last longer, but we are also investing it through the segments which have much more visibility for consistent growth. Lower cyclicality, for example, are there segments within the cyclical sectors which can give you more consistent returns, like fast moving industrial goods, because ye inka replacement cycle jo hai wo itna chota hai ki aapko inki regular zarurat padegi. And I'll give you a data point ki jab hamara industrial production growth rate was only 3-4%, still these companies were able to grow their top line by 10-11%. So that's the kind of nature of these businesses which help us reduce the cyclicality in the fund and more durable returns. Simple businesses, focus on execution. Continuously, we are tracking the data points in each of these sectors. Leadership in the industry, most of the companies, you know, have very strong innovation track record in each of the category, and that is what is helping them become leaders and survive through the cycles. And then definitely, you know, we look at strong financial metrics in terms of return ratios, management profile, and valuations. So what we are trying to do is reduce the risk, own good businesses, and have more consistent returns. Now, coming on to the aspect in terms of returns in the construction space, or the risks in the construction space. So what we are seeing is that even in the construction space, see, we have India as a country has gone through the learning cycle. We have learned from our mistakes because we were, you know, building our infrastructure for the first time. But now we have learned quite a lot. And from 2014, actually, a lot of changes which government brought in. So that is what has, you know, brought on the risk. And even in the construction sector, what we are seeing is that there are companies which have net cash balance sheets. There are companies which have shown strong execution track record and survived through the cycle. So I think that is the very, you know, strict way how we pick companies in each of the sectors. And that is our framework to identify ideas and build the design of the fund. Yeah. So that's all from my side. Over to you, Rohit.
Thank you, Charanjit. So friends, just to, you know, in few lines, if you're investing or positive on a particular thematic, so what works for the theme? So this engineering, infra, manufacturing theme, top down, what I spoke to you in the beginning, the government focus, macros, fiscal deficit, government spends, I think they seem to be going in the right direction. Two, on the bottom up, when you're looking at businesses, so what's happened in the last 2-3 years is the businesses have become stronger. By stronger, what I mean is when you look at the balance sheet and when you look at the debt equity ratios, debt coverage, interest coverage ratios, they have become very, very strong. So if tomorrow the cycle changes or they want to spend more, it is easy for them to go and ask a bank for a loan. One. Two, I'll just give you with another example. Like we spoke about cement and steel expansion, right? So whatever expansion these companies are doing today, more than 60%, they're using the internal cash. They're going to a lender only for that balance 30-40%. So this is, you know, the way if you have a strong balance sheet and a strong business, how you can take advantage of first rising utilization levels in your business, and then two, suddenly demand pick up and therefore benefiting from doing higher capex. So I think this is what Charanjit and I wanted to talk to you about. The DSP Tiger Fund and why we think, you know, it is a theme which everyone should look at it very keenly. Over to you, Nikhil, now.
Thanks, Rohit. Thanks, Charan. That was quite an insightful session. We will go for the Q&As. But before we go for the Q&As, request the audience, there is a feedback tab on your mobiles or your devices where you're watching the session. Please go and do give us your feedback. That helps us improve our sessions. We move on to our first question. Our first question is from Mr. Shamin Dalal. His question is, how do you participate in data center theme, as probably there is no pure play listed players as of now?
Okay, I'll take the question. So as you rightly mentioned, even when we mentioned in the beginning, there are no data center players. But if today a data center has to be set up in the country, it is like building a, you know, say a hospital. So what do you need to build a hospital? First, you need steel, cement, etc. Data center will need a lot of power, you know, one, because when data centers run, they consume a lot of power. To run a data center, if the power goes away, you need backup power. Data centers need a lot of cooling, you know, air conditioning. They need a lot of wiring, cabling. So automatically, if a new data center and the size that the government is talking about has to happen, then companies who are in that value chain will benefit initially. Because like I said, I don't see any companies who own data centers just listing by itself in the near future. So companies probably in the end who will turn up owning data centers as a subsidiary, that will be after 4-5 years. But till then, the company, whatever stuff goes into building a data center, that value chain will benefit.
Yeah, so just to add what Rohit also talked about, so if you look at the, you know, opportunity in data centers, and if I have to split it amongst, 30% is what is related to power equipment, because like Rohit mentioned, it's a power related, you know, capex which happens. 15% is automation. Another 15% will be HVAC, which is cooling. And then you have the other, you know, segments like power backup, which will be around 10 to 15%. So what we are trying to capture is the opportunity which comes in the beginning in terms of building those data centers. So what we are seeing is as the capacity becomes 5x by FY26, there's a lot of built up which is going to happen. Who are the players? Because these data centers are going to be set up by global level players. What we are talking about, hyperscale data centers now in Indian context. And these are much larger, where globally approved products will be only preferred. So that is where we see that there is a good demand which will come for power related equipment, automation, HVAC, and for the backup. That's the opportunity which we see.
Thanks a lot. Our next question is from Mr. Amit Kumar Singh. He's saying, what's your view on PSUs in the power and energy sector? And what is the allocation of PSUs in the Tiger Fund?
Chiranji, do you want to take it or should I?
Yeah. So if you look at the power sector itself, what is happening is that power sector is undergoing 2-3 major transitions. So transitions in the sense, one, we are seeing a shift from the coal-based to renewable-based capacity additions. Secondly, what we are seeing is that there are big reforms which are being talked on the distribution side. So in the renewable space, what we are seeing is that the traction is very recent, where companies as utilities have started moving from coal-based to renewable-based capacities. And there are very large targets now which have come up even from the PSUs in terms of what is the kind of capacity addition what they want to do. So that is one shift which is coming. Secondly, what is going to happen is that as a country now we have not been adding a lot more coal-based power plants, but coal continues to be the mainstay of power as of now, or to meet our key requirements. And what will also happen is as our demand rises, what we start seeing is that the utilization levels or the PLFs for these existing plants start to going up. That's the second aspect. Third aspect, in terms of the distribution reforms, what it is going to do is that it is going to improve the health of the distribution companies or the last mile of the value chain. And that creates much better receivable cycles for the PSUs or the power sector companies. So what we are seeing is CapEx happening on renewables, balance sheet improving through the health of the distribution sector improving, utilization levels or PLFs going up as the demand picks up, as we start more manufacturing, not more coal-based capacities coming in, so existing assets get sweat more. So that creates more value for these companies as they are able to scale up in each of these segments what we are talking about.
Right. And coming to your point on PSU and power, right? So we own quite a few PSUs, but for us, you know, the categorization is business. First, we should like a business and then we see, you know, how to categorize it. So we own PSUs into logistics, into power generation, defense and manufacturing. That is again led by a pure bottom-up idea. Second, when we talk about power today, right, and we talk about industries consuming power, today there are a lot of industries who don't consume thermal power, they consume natural gas, LNG, right? So who are the gas utilities? Like today, you know, we know coal-powered fired plants, right? Who are the utilities who are supplying natural gas to these consumers? So they are also in a way proxy to the pure old power which we know. So yes, we have a significant allocation to PSU companies, but it is the business which they are in driving our investments, not the tag of PSU or private. And on the power side also, as we go ahead, you know, there'll be various definitions of power, like gas utilities today, right? And I will not name them, but the Gujarat government owns a lot of gas utilities who supply, you know, gas to the industries over there. So that's how, you know, the blocks are being built up.
Thanks a lot, Rohit. There is a follow-up question from Mr. Singh. So can the fund be considered for 3 to 5 years investment horizon?
So like Charanjit and I also mentioned, right, the way we have built up the fund and the businesses which we have bought in today. So the first point was, we're coming to you with a 3 to 5 year view, because these businesses, yes, their end may be the customer, or maybe near time, they may be cyclical, but inherently they have a steady state businesses with good cash generation, good ROEs, which not only in the good cycle, even in a bad cycle, you know, they have demonstrated that kind of, you know, financial strength. One. Two, Charanjit mentioned about the construction and infra companies and balance sheet. So today, you know, we own 4 companies in the pure road construction today. 3 of them are net debt, net cash companies, and one of them has got hardly any debt. So when I look at the business profile, what we're seeing over the next 2 to 5 years, the strength of balance sheet and how the management talks, what is his vision? Last 5-7, see, now we have a hindsight benefit, right? In the last bad cycle, last good cycle, what did the management do? How did they behave? So that gives us the confidence when you look at the filtration, right? Business is good, balance sheet is good, but management can be tricky. So the weighting has to be done accordingly. So all these aspects combined with the macro top-down view, which we spoke to you about, gives us the confidence to talk about this fund from a 2 to 5 year perspective, not from a 6 month to 1 year perspective.
Yeah, and Nikhil, just to add here, you know, what Rohit also talked about, this visibility part. So if you look at, like, for example, road sector, there's a good visibility that the ordering could continue for next 3 to 5 years. There's a pipeline which is built. railways, this year we have seen lifetime high capex, and government is talking about sustaining that 2 lakh crores of spending going forward, because there is a big focus on transportation and in terms of increasing the speed of railways, increasing its percentage share in freight itself. So you cannot do that without spending, and that too you have to sustain that spending for 3 to 5 years. Water, like Rohitji talked about, how we are seeing, you know, that availability is there, but water per capita, it's not, you know, that great. So you have to spend. This is at a situation, water is at a situation that we don't have an option. Otherwise, we'll be having, you know, wars amongst states. So we have to continuously spend, and that to the pipeline where we have a now new ministry also for Jal Shakti, which is going and spending money for the next 5 years time frame. Similarly, like the other categories which we have talked about, be it automation, industries are just starting. You know, this is just a beginning for them to start spending on this. Defense, I'll give you another example. There's a negative import list which has been introduced. Uska matlab kya hai? Ki pehle we used to import those products from abroad. Government has said zero now imports from abroad. This has to be sourced from domestic companies. What it creates is 4 lakh crores worth of opportunity, which is there for domestic companies over the next 4 to 5 years. So what we have done is, like Rohitji talked about, each segment by segment, if it is meeting that criteria to give us that growth visibility, that's how you build it up. Yeah.
The next question is from Mr. Sivakumar Ramaswamy. This question is, do you see cold chain infrastructure investments growth due to farm reforms? If yes, who are the players, domestic or international?
Can you take it?
Sorry, Nikhil, I didn't get your question.
I'll just repeat the question. Mr. Sivakumar is asking, do you see cold chain infrastructure investment growth due to farm reforms? If yes, then who are the players, domestic or international?
Yeah, see, the cold chain, actually that business has been talked about quite a lot in terms of we want to build that chain. And we are seeing, you know, already some investments happening in the food and beverage space. There are companies who have, you know, commercial refrigeration business, who supply commercial refs to these industries, and we are seeing the increasing traction. But a lot of those components still were getting imported, and now only what we are seeing is that those industries starting to add capacities in India. And these are, you know, refrigeration manufacturers who are doing commercial scale refrigeration, and now they are building up capacities for the Indian requirement. And that scale up is going to happen. So I think how you can play that is first through the equipment suppliers who are going to supply that commercial refrigeration equipment. And the secondly, then the owners who will be owning those supply chains in terms of the commercial refrigeration. That's the right way. And I think that definitely will pick up as food and beverage industry is seeing the investment. It is getting more formalized. So I think cooling requirement will continue to increase, and we have good commercial refrigeration place in the listed space. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. The next question is from Mr. Roshan Thakkar. He's saying, Mr. Thakkar is saying that Mr. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala just mentioned the Electricity Amendment Act as the new game changer. If you could throw some light on how it's also positioned within your portfolio.
Okay, so the Electricity Generation Act, it's not a new act. It came a few months back. You know, so that is there. So what was announced in that act, right? So it's nothing new. So what they had said is, today, as in consumer, if I'm staying in Bombay, right? I can take power from Tata Power or BSES, the Adani, right? And in some cities and tier two towns, you have no option. So there could be a case whereby the distribution will be opened up. So if I am a consumer sitting in Bombay and maybe staying in an apartment which has got 20 flats, but I decide I want to buy power from Nikhil Kamath's company, I can do that. Eventually, I will have that option. So what they are trying to do is they're trying to open up distribution. That's one. Secondly, what it does is today, right? So today we all know that, you know, we have heard the State Electricity Board, SEB, in the last 20 years and how they have messed up the entire power value chain, right? Because they buy power at high cost, but they sell to you and me at a low cost because they look at election, they look at what may happen in the future, what are the political compulsions, right? In turn, if you're an industry, instead of selling you power at 5-7 rupees a unit, they sell you power at 10 rupees a unit because they are selling me power cheaper. On the farm side, they are not taking, you know, they are not charging them anything. So what this act talks about is, say, a example, I give you like a prepaid meter. So if you're a, you know, farmland owner, so you'll give 10,000 rupees, you'll get a electricity worth 10,000. The time the 10,000 goes away, you don't prepay, your electricity is stopped, right? So these are the kind of things, you know, the electricity tax is talking about. What it does to the value chain, if it happens the way it is expected to happen, then it gives businesses the option to become distributors. So like, you know, you must have seen a lot of cities in Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, they are being privatized, the distribution over there. You know, they are taking over the city distribution. They are saying we'll reduce the losses and whatever profits we get, it will be our profit. So you'll have more and more such businesses opportunities for people who are under this value chain. Like one of the companies we own, you know, they have about 3 or 4 distribution licenses. Mm-hmm. So it may not be the case, they are power manufacturers, but they distribute. So this is a whole value chain. So the view is, if this goes right, one, the financial leakage which was happening, the chori bolte hai na, ek to power ki chori and paise ki chori. Those two should get clubbed and should be done away hopefully in few years to come. The state electricity boards will be in a better financial position. The lenders to them will be in a better financial position. And you and me in the consumer. Today, I mean, sitting in Bombay, we are lucky. But if you go to a lot of cities, still you don't get power for 7, 8 hours a day. So even if you have to pay 50 paisa, 1 rupee more for that power, and if you're guaranteed 24/7, I think that is what the Act inversely says is. How much time it's been? I think Ranjit, 5.5-6 months since they first came out in February, right? They came out.
The draft has been out. Yeah.
Since February, so it is not new. A lot of companies are working towards it. So I would put it to that. You know, I would not lay my thought process on what one person is saying to what different it can be. It is what the Act says, and if you believe in it, the companies. So coming to a specific Tiger Fund, we have a lot of companies who are also engaged in distribution. Right, who distribute and, you know, who have taken up things. So we have companies into power generation and power transmission. So that's how we are playing into that.
Sure. Thanks a lot. We have the next question from Mr. Ronak Mansukla Shah. Before we take the question, people, if you have many more questions, please put it on the question tab, and please do go on the feedback tab for giving us your feedback. So the question from Mr. Ronak Shah is, sir, is Tiger ready to roar? Also, it has slightly underperformed your existing flagship schemes. Can we invest seeing better upside compared to our other flagship funds?
So I would say, you know, whenever you're comparing, say, a thematic fund with a diversified fund, I think it's not an apples to apples comparison, right? So today, when I'm coming to you with Tiger, what am I telling you? So today, anyone asks me a question, ki, Rohit Charanjit, you are so bullish on Tiger. How much money should I put in Tiger, right? That's the first question. And my answer to that has been pretty straight. See, sir, if you're investing 100 rupees in an equity diversified total mutual fund asset, you have 100 rupees. I think up to 15 to 17 rupees is a fair allocation to a thematic fund like Tiger, right? And why I'm saying you this is, right? Today, when I look at the quality of companies in the Tiger fund, the quality is as good, as bad as my equity opportunity fund or the tax saver fund, right? In terms of quality. But being a thematic fund, you know, every theme has got its own time frame. At times, it may underperform or outperform. Last 1 year, the Tigers outperformed most of the schemes, you know, which as DSP we run. Because, you know, initially it was run down, suddenly things were changing. So I would say, I would not compare the returns, but what I can tell you is, the fact I'm talking to you about 2 to 5 years, I'm not talking to you about 1 to 2 years or 6 months to 1 year. It's giving me that confidence that even if things has to go little haywire for short periods of time, the endeavor is that, but never, you cannot predict the future. We will be not left far, far behind, you know, if things go averse to what we are thinking right now.
Perfect.
So Nikhil, before we take the last question, I think I should have told this in the beginning. So for all my friends, you know, you have been tracking the Tiger Fund. One difference you would have noticed when you saw the February end fact sheet, right? You'd have seen no financials in the Tiger Fund, which used to be around 25 to 35% of the AUM till September, October last year. So one call internally we took, though as per the mandate, we are allowed to invest in banks and NBFCs. One call we took is, if this is the scenario we are seeing for industrial, engineering and manufacturing companies, first, let us only focus on these kind of companies. Secondly, when I look at banks and NBFCs, when I look at my fund only, the one which I manage, you know, they have 35% plus allocation in this space. All outside, on average, the funds have 20 to 35% allocation. So if you are an investor who's believing in this theme, again, if I give you the 20-35% financials, then I'm taking away the whole, you know, thematic positivity which we have. So we decided, you know, as an internal, we will not buy into banks and NBFCs. Why banks and NBFCs is because they play on the asset and balance sheet, right? So they're leveraging their balance sheet to grow. Things can go up and down. But on the other side, we will continue to invest in financial platforms companies or life insurance companies. By what do I mean by financial platforms? So right now we don't own any of them, but I'll give you some examples, right? Like we have a company called CAMS, you know, we may have, you know, our exchanges getting listed and all those. So those companies are like pure business companies, right? They don't lever their balance sheet. In case the business goes down, yes, their profits will come down, but their net worth will not get eroded. Same for insurance companies. So where we find those, if you find something good in those businesses, we will buy them, but we'll avoid buying banks and NBFCs. I should have told us in the front, I forgot about it. So just, you know, let me just convey this message to everyone. Over to you, Nikhil. Thank you.
Sure. There are a couple of more questions. One is from Nitin Sachdeva. Do you think we should go the SIP way or lump sum right now in this fund?
So I said, if you're not only in this fund, if you're looking to invest in any other fund also, I would say take the advantage of next 30-45 days, do a STP or a SIP route. Why I'm saying this is, had we met 3 months back, my answer would have been the same. You would have said, Rohit, you have gone wrong, the way markets have behaved, right? But as we see things today, I think, see what's happening. On the bottom-up side, when I look at my diversified funds also, companies are showing better earnings, the managements are confident, so are we, you know, looking at their balance sheet and all. On the top-down side, we don't see any negatives per se, right? But we are entering a phase whereby, you know, the US is talking about tightening, etc., how things may pan out. So we went back to history. And again, here, why I cannot say for sure is you have to go back to history and say what had happened during that period of time, right? So usually when the tantrum talks start and when the tightening actually starts, the market corrects only in the first few months. Then the markets are on their own fancy, the fundamentals take away. Like for budget, we will talk 1 week before the budget, 1 week after the budget. So many questions will come. In May, we will forget what had happened in the budget. So I think looking at some, you know, variances or possibilities, I would say next 1-1.5 months, spread your investments over that rather than going burn out today or tomorrow. I'd put it that way.
Perfect. Next question is from Lakshmi Venkatachalam. We have made good money in your natural resources fund. Would you still recommend us investing more into it or should we stay long? How long should we stay invested?
Okay. So again, the last point which I mentioned about the US tightening, right? So when I go back to history and we look at commodities, there is a case whereby, you know, commodities underperform for a few months. That's one. Now, what is different in this cycle, right? So when I look at my DSP Tiger fund, it is not a pure commodity fund. It is not a pure metals fund. As we stand, you know, we have about 38-39% in metals, same amount in oil and gas and energy, and about 22% in the two BlackRock global funds. So right now it's a very diversified fund as I see it today. I feel as an investor, you should stay on to it and have a relook at it after 1.5 months of fresh investments. Why I'm saying is, when I look at commodities today, right? When you look at any steel names or any aluminium names in the fund today, you see again their balance sheet, sir. And what I was telling you for the general market, this is a sector specifically who have seen great, great deleveraging. I mean, I'm a metal analyst for the last 20 years now. I couldn't have imagined that debt equity ratio of these companies can go less than 0.5, right? So the ROEs can be sustainable at 12%+. So on the metal side, that is giving me the confidence. On the oil and gas side, the reforms, I mean, you see the way crude has moved up. Yes, you and me are not happy with the petrol and diesel price. But see what's happening, right? Government is passing on. So the company's business model is continuing. Oil today, I'm not a guru in oil, but I've been saying since last year that $50 oil nahi lagta hai. It should be around between 65 to 70. It's almost at 80 today. So, I mean, it is not hurting us in any way. So, I would say, like I said, for Tiger, NRNE is a more tight fund, right? Because there are only 3 segments you can invest into. But looking at the data points, the deleveraging, I would still not ask a person to remove money out of it.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Rohit. Our next question is from Mr. Rakesh Singhvi. How insurance companies are related with the Tiger theme?
Okay, so this forms as a part of, if you see, the economic reform. Okay, now I'll just give you an example before I go to your final answer to that. Today, Tiger is also, you know, when we say, we talk about economic reform. So as a fund manager today, I can justify any company as economic reform. I can buy a pharma company, IT company, and an automobile passenger car also. I will say government is focusing more on roads. We'll have better roads, so let me buy a car company also, right? There's an indirect beneficiary. Now, where does insurance come in? So first, insurance is a part of financial, the big sector, you know, insurance comes under that. So as per the information memorandum, we are allowed to invest in this space. But why insurance today? We have lower taxation on insurance companies. Today, India, I mean, yes, we are a nation of huge population. How many of us are insured today? You know, even if in this group we have, if you ask people to put up hands, I'm sure there'll be many hands which are not put up. See, how many of us do have a simple term plan? This is the whole penetration theme. This is, you know, people talk about an FMCG auto TAM, what is a target excess market, right? For insurance, this is the biggest. We already have a population. We already have a big set of working population, which is increasing every year. So this is the penetration level. So that's how the insurance theme fits into the Tiger. So I can, if you want a simple answer, I can justify it as under economic reform, but they are catering to that whole growth of the nation, the insurance businesses. That's why.
Yeah, and just to add, Nikhil, another thing is the entire thought process of having a cyclical and secular growth sectors matching in the fund. So that gives you more, you know, stability in terms of how you are mixing the cyclical and secular growth sectors, where you have more consistent growth rate, like we talked about consumer electrics, consumer durables. So again, more lower penetration of some of these products and a consistent growth trajectory, what we can see led by the increasing penetration.
Perfectly. That was the last question. So thank you. I'd like to have some closing remarks from Rohit before we close the session for today.
I think, friends, first of all, thank you for giving us this opportunity and hearing us out. I think Charan and me are quite, you know, confident coming to you all and talking to you about themes. Whatever we have shown you in the presentation is what we are seeing. And I'm sure you must have heard or read part about in the newspaper and media also. I would urge you all, you know, very soon, maybe in a day or two, a fact sheet will be out. A digital fact sheet should be out, I think, in 1 day or two. Have a look at the stocks which we own in the fund. And related to what Chiranjit and I have spoken to you or shown you in the presentation. And this is what is giving us the confidence. Next 2 to 5 years, one should not miss this out. And allocation, I have already told you, I'm not asking you for a 50, 70, 80%, because in the thematic fund, even I understand. You know, there are restrictions to the fund manager also, what I can do in those bad times. But it's definitely worth a look. If you all have any questions, do get back, you know, to our colleagues from DSP. And of course, they'll get back to Chiranjit and me. And we will try to answer to best of our knowledge, you know, whatever we can. And all the best. Take care, please, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Rohit. Thanks a lot, Chiranjit. Thanks, everyone. And we'll be having a series of such sessions which can give you slightly more info into our products, portfolios, and also the thoughts and ideas that we put to them. Thanking you all. Have a nice weekend. Until then, we see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.